Welcome back. Let us resume the solution to the problem. There's a lot of intense working in the last class to convert the partial differential equation into an ordinary differential equation which can be solved more easily. But that's one of the ways of solving a partial differential equation if you recall from your mathematics classes. So this was the converted differential equation, the ordinary differential equation, minus 2 eta d theta d eta equals d squared theta by d eta squared, with the converted boundary conditions in terms of the non-dimensional parameters. We want to solve it in terms of non-dimensional parameters so that the solution becomes applicable in general. This is the problem that we are considering is the sorption of a surface modifying agent from the liquid onto a surface. We are interested in the concentration profiles of the surface modifying agent or the SMA in the liquid at various points in time. To solve this ODE, let us put u equals d theta dE. If it is ODE, you know how to solve this. This is one of the ways of doing it. U equals d theta d eta. Thus, du d eta, which is what we have there, is nothing but d squared theta by d eta squared. And therefore, the differential equation becomes minus 2 eta u equals du d eta. And if you, or you could write this as du by u equals minus 2 eta d eta. And therefore, you could write this as d ln u equals minus 2 eta d eta. And therefore, ln u is nothing but the integral of minus 2 eta d eta. And the solution is quite straightforward here. Ln u equals minus eta squared, the 2 to cancel, plus the constant of integration. And therefore, u is nothing but, which is d theta by d eta, is c1 exponential of minus eta squared. So, this is the solution of u. We still have this. We could, one of the ways of doing the solution is that you could use a series expansion for this. Okay, you all know what a series expansion for an exponential function is. So, a series expansion converts it into additive terms, then you can, integration is quite straightforward, you do not have this complication here. So, that is one way of doing it. I am going to show you two ways of doing it, and the second way becomes a lot more general. Or it is nice to know the second way also. You see that quite often it leads you to a particular function that is used a lot of times, the error function and so on. So, let me show you this. So, e power minus exponential of minus eta squared, if you expand it, is nothing but 1 minus eta squared by 1 factorial plus eta power 4 by 2 factorial, this is minus eta squared, remember. So, and alternate of minus and pluses and minuses, so minus eta power 6 by 3 factorial plus so on. If you integrate this, you could get eta minus eta cube by 3 into 1 factorial plus eta power 5 by 5 into 2 factorial and so on and so forth, plus the constant of integration. And I'm more interested in this alternative route. So, this gives you a solution. This certainly gives you a solution, series expansion solution. However, there is an alternative route that exists. To do that, I am going to go back a few steps, and we will keep the integral sign for some steps because it becomes clearer. So, if you go back a few steps, somewhere here, and start integrating that, and start processing that, theta is nothing but c1 exponential of minus eta squared d eta plus c2. Okay, that is the integral that we had before we expanded this on a series expansion. So, here I will call this a dash. Now, if you apply the boundary conditions right away, as when eta equals 0, theta equals 1, when eta equals tends to infinity, then theta equals 0. If you apply these two boundary conditions, we get when you know, you have theta equals 1, c1 plus exponential of minus eta squared d eta at eta equals 0 plus c2, and we have theta equals 0 when eta tends to infinity. Therefore, you have that of the integral form here called the c dash. Now, from here, if you eliminate c2, subtract one from the other, we get minus 1. I am subtracting the first b dash from c dash. If I do that, I get minus 1 equals c1 exponential of minus eta squared d eta, eta tending at eta tending to infinity, minus of integral exponential of minus eta squared d eta at eta equal to 0. And this is nothing but 1 equals c equals 0 to infinity exponential of minus eta squared d eta. Okay, eta tending to 0, this integral minus this integral, you can write it as a definite integral. Then you know, there is a sign change here, because integral of 0 to infinity, so infinity minus that, and there is a negative there, so you get that. And the above definite integral is of a standard form. Okay, that's the reason why we wanted to keep the integral and c. This integral is called an error function, and the values of the integral between the lower limit of 0 and various upper limits are available in error function tables that are found in mathematical handbooks and of some of your mathematical textbooks even. You have the various values of this error function. It's the value of the area under the curve from 0 onwards. And when evaluated by expanding the series or by using the error function, the integral, this is 0 to infinity exponential of minus eta squared d eta, is nothing but square root of pi by 2. Okay, this you get from the mathematical tables. Therefore, from d dash, you get c1 equals minus 2 by square root of pi, okay, to make this equation consistent. And therefore, if you eliminate c2, then you get theta minus 1 equals c1 of exponential minus eta squared d eta at eta equals eta minus exponential of eta squared d eta, eta equals 0. And from there, you get theta equals 1 plus c1 times this exponential integral. And we need to differentiate between the limit eta on the integral and the eta in the integrand. This is the limit and this is a variable here in the integrand. Okay, these are two different aspects. They just turned out to be similar here, but they are two different concepts. You know this from math. And the integrand, this is a variable which can be replaced by x. We are going to do that here to avoid the confusion. And therefore, theta is nothing but 1 minus c1, which was minus 2 by square root of pi, integral of 0 to eta exponential of minus eta squared d eta, and that is nothing but 1 minus 2 by square root of pi exponential of minus x squared dx. We have replaced this variable eta by the variable x to avoid the confusion with the limit eta, and this is nothing but the error function of x that we mentioned here, and theta equals 1 minus the error function of eta, or this is called the ERFC, the error function C, the complementary error function of eta. 1 minus error function is the complementary error function, ERFC eta. So, replacing the non-dimensional variables with their dimensional equivalents, we have gotten this solution here, a nice compact solution. Now, we can replace the non-dimensional variables by the actual variables for our particular case. Therefore, this theta is nothing but ci minus c0 divided by cs by minus c0, and this is the complementary error function of z by square root of 4 dit, which is our eta. If you plot this on our earlier graph, remember I showed you this plot without these lines earlier, This is the concentration axis, Ci in the solution. This is the z axis, z equals 0 here. And at various times, you get various profiles. And as time increases, the profile shifts from here to here to here. Note, how do you read this? This is the z axis, this is the concentration axis. So, high on the concentration axis means a large value of concentration. So, somewhere here it reaches the highest concentration at a certain low time, then it drops to 0 at z equals 0. At a different time, which is beyond the initial time, then this one becomes like this. At a third time, which is beyond the first two times, it becomes like this, and so on and so forth. The time where it starts, from where it starts decreasing, goes on increasing on the z-axis scale. Now, let us look at the flux, which is what we need. Flux is again diffusive, there is no motion of the liquid, therefore the SMA flux is only diffusive. Therefore, you could use Fick's first law to get it, Ji star equals minus Di dou Ci dou x at z equals 0. And that in terms of theta and z turns out to be this, minus Di Cs minus C0 dou theta dou z at z equals 0. And this is nothing but, as we already seen, d theta d eta d eta d dou eta dou z at z equals 0. And for that, we have an expression now, Ji star equals Di Cs minus C naught square root of, this is square root of 4 dit, 1 by square root of 4 dit, and this remains d theta d eta at eta equals 0, equation 2.5-11, and this is nothing but the complementary error function of eta, and that's a different integral. And now we need to differentiate the theta, we need to differentiate with respect to eta, and therefore we are differentiating a definite integral, and that is what we need to do to find flux. So this is another aspect which is not trivial. We need to have this is a different concept altogether. We are differentiating an integral. However, if you recall your math course, you would recall the Leibniz rule, which provides us with a way of differentiating an integral. So, this can be found, and this is what the Leibniz rule says, as integral of a1t to a2t dou t of fxt dx plus the functional value at the upper limit times dA2 dt minus the functional value at the lower limit times dA1 dt. Okay. So, this is what our Leibniz rule tells us. Here you have theta equals 1 minus 2 by square root of pi 0 to eta exponential of minus x squared dx. The derivative that is needed is nothing but d theta by d eta. And that turns out to be, of course, this is 0 if you take it with respect to eta, and then you need the derivative of this, d of d eta of this integral. According to Leibniz rule, we have minus this derivative can be written as minus 2 by square root of pi integral of 0 to eta dou eta of exponential of minus squared plus the function which is exponential of minus eta squared evaluated at the upper limit, then d eta is 1 minus the value of the function evaluated at the lower limit exponential of minus 0 squared d 0 by d eta. So, this is 1, this is 0, and therefore, the function inside the integral is not a function of eta, the first term is 0, the last term is 0, and therefore, you get d theta d eta is minus 2 by pi exponential of minus eta squared. Okay. Therefore, you have d theta d eta, which is what we are looking for the flux, as the derivative of this from here minus 2 exponential minus eta squared by square root of pi at eta equals 0. So when you evaluate this at eta equals 0, it equals to minus 2 by square root of pi. Therefore, the flux turns out to be, if you substitute this back into the expression for the flux, you will get square root of dAb by pi t times Cs minus C naught. Okay. dAb is nothing but dI itself. This is sometimes used in a binary system. We don't have to worry about this too much. I am going to use this dAb, dI, dI effective in the same sense. Only thing is that it's a slightly different situation, therefore I call it dI effective and so on. So all these are interchangeably used in this course, so please don't get confused. So dAb is the same as dI, Cs minus C naught. Equation 2.5-12. So we got an expression for the flux that was required when the surface modifying agent is being absorbed onto a surface from a stationary liquid. This had quite a bit of intense mathematics, but that is required as a part of this course, and that was a prerequisite. The mathematics, engineering mathematics, was a prerequisite for this course. But don't worry about it. I've given you every single step here. In most books, you don't have these individual steps. Therefore, it is difficult to follow, and that kind of puts off many students. That's the reason why I've spent time to show you most of these steps till a certain basal point. Beyond that, you need to work out yourself. Okay. Let's stop here. And when we meet in the next class, we will take things forward. See you then.